So, what a great start to this morning, whether it was Mr. Sani setting the stage, not just of what AI can do, but just how seriously the government is taking on aspects like privacy. It's heartening to see how much investment collectively is going, not just by the government, but the entire ecosystem. And then I think Kaustubh kind of just set the stage with respect to, you know, the use cases around AI, whether he talked of agriculture, we hear of healthcare, he talked of the entire ecosystem, starting from skilling, so universities and what's happening there, to startups, to, you know, partners, customers, and the space. So this is actually a very nice segue into what I'm going to cover today on behalf of Microsoft, which is that what is Microsoft doing in this space to equip this ecosystem to kind of take their next journey on artificial intelligence with us. So very quickly, if we talk about where we are and where are we going, so if you look at some of these companies, right, so what's special about these companies? What you'll notice as a common theme is that each of them has kind of used software or technology to disrupt a traditional industry, right? So if we take Ola as an example, so whether it was a cab kind of business or a taxi business, they completely disrupted it by getting an application experience, and they're not pausing there, right? Every time that you go to or use an Ola, your experience as an end user, as a consumer, is just getting better and better, right? And I'm sure the same thing you'll be able to relate to, whether it's Skype, whether I'm Flipkart, and the likes, Amazon in the same space, and so on. So what's the pattern we are seeing? I think we started a journey which kind of started with software, but it's not stopping there. We are getting into the next phase, or we are already into the next phase, where we are using analytics. And then ultimately, we are using artificial intelligence across industries to kind of ride the next generation of digital transformation. So just to quote a few examples, if you see manufacturing, we are already there where companies are using predictive maintenance from a safety standpoint, from a cost standpoint, to manage their large scale plants. If you look at retail, so whether it is an Amazon Go-like store where you can basically have a smart checkout experience, no human intervention, just how they're managing their inventory, or how they are asking, let's say if a Pepsi rack in a store, the Pepsi folks can actually have a complete idea of how it's distributed on physical racks and if it's getting the right footage or not, just sitting in their office, right? So every single industry is using and riding on this next wave. And let's kind of delve into, what are some of the underlying facets around that. So obviously, it starts with data, right? So whether there are a bunch of us in this room, I think we are generating so much data just sitting here, right? Whether it's on our cell phones, we have other devices, some people have their laptops open, tablets, and so on. You put it in a factory situation, you put it in your car, every single place is generating data ranging from megabytes to gigabytes to terabytes, right? So that's kind of the baseline of what's going on. Move it to a scale of a stadium, and then you can imagine, what's going on there. Never mind all, the highly technology-driven sports that we, a world that we now live in, right? So if it was all about storage of data, I think there have always been traditional companies, whether it's Microsoft, whether it's Oracle, IBM, the works. I think everybody will provide you ways to store your data, and the data size is just exploding, right? But it's also a fact that it's only a really, really small percent, like single digit of that data, that we are actually able to make sense out of, right? And that is where we really want to invest as an organization on how we can help in your journey to make that data useful, right? And so whether it is agriculture, whether it's healthcare, there are various ways to actually make that data into an actionable. And so I'll talk a little more about it as we go along. So just moving to some of the basic ingredients that we have. The foundational thing that Microsoft is providing towards this journey is the intelligent cloud and intelligent edge. And very quickly on the intelligent edge, where we want to make sure that every endpoint of yours can behave like a server, can be as powerful as a server, right, and can help you do smarts like a server. So imagine a situation where you're driving in your car in Bombay traffic at 20 kilometers per hour, 30 kilometers per hour, right? If you really wanted to do some smart analytics about your car or based on the smarts of your car, obviously you're not in a situation where you're going to send data back to the cloud, do some computing, get, so there is a real-timeness and there is an edge requirement in terms of what you really want to get out of it, right? So that's one aspect of it, that there's kind of almost a ubiquitous focus, whether you're talking about, you know, the cloud, which is super powerful, you know, can scale, etc., etc., but all the way down to your smallest of device, whether it's a bulb or a dashboard or something else. So that's one part. And then what we really want to use that is a framework to provide you, as I said, a consistent, ubiquitous experience to be able to give you a foundation to infuse artificial intelligence into it, and then, of course, provide personalization. Because today we are living in a world which has completely moved away from providing mass experience, right, to it's all about me as an end user, right? So whether I'm, you know, I'm interacting with the bank, whether I want to buy a car, whether I'm in a retail experience, whether I want to buy something online, it's all about me and how much you know me and how much you can give me experiences right on the platform, right? So just moving forward again, talking a little bit on the infra readiness, we have the largest kind of density of Azure kind of spread across the regions, 50 plus regions, 140 odd countries, and ever expanding. So one of the things I do want to kind of just bring out, which I saw recently, and I was sharing this in one of my earlier talks also, which is that a lot of you may have seen stickers on your cars, and typically it will be on a small car, like in the old times, Maruti 800, maybe more recently on an i10 or something, which would say that my other car is a Mercedes. Have you guys seen this sticker? Okay, so I just recently saw one of my engineer friends from Microsoft who had this sticker, said my other computer is Azure. And I thought that was so cool, and that was such a simple way to explain what Azure is and what Azure should mean for you in your journey, right? And then coming back to the density, it's not just about the density, but it's also the expanse. And so whether it is a complete cloud solution, whether you want to do a hybrid solution, so there is the Azure stack, to the really smart endpoints, very lightweight but very smart, which is all about edge. And then finally, something we introduced recently, which is Sphere, which basically gives you a very cost-effective way to still deliver intelligence on from your various devices. So, I mean, some of you may have already seen these really simple demos, which might be something as, you know, as basic as I want my barbecue to switch on at whatever 7:30 p.m. in the evening, and you know, Sphere being kind of there, and I could basically simply code it and get it going, right? So that's kind of the complete stack. And just coming back to the Azure penetration, one of the experiment, and now it seems like we might scale further, that we've seen is having a data center underwater. Right, and this is something, it's a project called Natic that we've already launched. It is a production quality data center already live, and that's been a really interesting breakthrough. Apart from providing really, really cool video, you should go and check this project out, and we continuously tend to send kind of recordings from there. We're also looking at it considering so many of the inhabitants on this planet, and especially where there is a lot of industry. So whether you look at a New York or a Bay Area or whatever, it's so close to water. So if you could find a cost viable and environment friendly way to host data centers underwater, it also becomes an alternate from a DR perspective that would just allow a different level of scaling as we move forward. So a little bit on AI itself and what we are doing. So our approach has been at two levels as we have looked at AI, in terms of how we can infuse AI into everything we build, in terms of every product we build, and I'll talk a little bit about that. And then the second piece is maybe how you, whether you're a startup, whether you're an enterprise, whether you're small scale, you're wanting to build something, whether you're a government, a body who's trying to, for example, invest in agriculture, and you know, what does the next gen agri look like? What we would like to really do is to partner with you on this AI journey. It's not like it's an out-of-the-box solution, and it's much more of a platform, and I'll be talking a little more on that. But before we go to that, just taking a step back before we dive into those details, which is that what has really changed for us? And I'm sure, you know, with all of you sitting in the room, I don't need to kind of remind you, but so quickly I'll just touch upon the thing. Of course, your computing power, it's completely exploded on what's possible, right? The huge amounts of data, thanks to the internet revolution, thanks to the mobile and the mobility and the devices that we now have. And then, of course, the algorithms. Now, if you look at algorithms per se, and let's even take neural network as kind of the, one of the underlying kind of framework of what even today all our models, many of our models are built on. So literally, it's been there since the 1940s, right? That's how old it is, right? So we do need to call out that a lot of this revolution has been when the time is right, and thanks to the computing power, and thanks to another very important element that we have been hearing even in this conversation today, and I hear this in pretty much every conversation that I go to around AI, which is one element of democratization, right? And the second element of AI for all, right? And when I talk about democratization, one side of it that is pushed, especially the engineering and the data scientists, is about how they think openly. So no longer are we restricted to a place that if I'm using a Microsoft thing, I will not use TensorFlow. If I'm using X model, I'll not collaborate with this other person, to get a model which is much faster. We are now living in a space where we are trying to get to a global maxima very quickly, using frameworks like GitHub, for example, where I can actually, collaborate with anybody from any other organization, my own organization, any part of the geography, and so on. So there's also been a huge acceleration in my potential to get to the best algorithm, not worrying about it being my algorithm, which is what at least a whole generation of developers kind of, grew that. So just want to acknowledge that piece of it. So very quickly, in terms of just Microsoft and what it's been specifically doing in the field of AI from an advancement perspective, literally you'll notice in the last 2 years, right, we have achieved human parity on different fronts. So starting with object recognition to more recently translation, right? So literally we have beaten or equaled what a human can do in a lot of our abilities as a human being. And mostly around, I still see it as sense organs being the theme of what that is, right? So whether it's our ability to see, whether it's our ability to listen, whether it's our ability to comprehend, right? So that's something that, not just us, many companies and startups, like they're very, very systematically disrupting what's possible there, giving a huge rise to what's possible. So then moving on, I'll just share two elements of then, diving into the, what is Microsoft doing specifically in AI. One, which is more around you as an end user of Microsoft products, and the other with respect to enterprises. So if I talk to you from a product perspective, so how many of you have seen or used the recent Outlook, which has now two tabs, Focus and Other? How many of you are, okay, many of you, right? Okay, so that's just like the beginning. There are aspects like My Analytics. Are you guys using that in your Outlook, where it tells you how many hours you spent on the email, who did you interact with most, And some of it can just be, okay, whatever, I have like one more mail to deal with. That's the way you will look at it. Or the other is that something can actually stand out for you to say, what am I doing? Like, why am I spending 6 hours of my 12-hour workday on Outlook? Like, something is wrong. Or, oh, I didn't realize I spent so much time with this person. Am I micromanaging that person? Or whatever it may be, right? So there are real analytics which we are trying to infuse in your daily products. Another similar example is LinkedIn. And let's say if you wanted to make a resume on your Word document, starting from where it will propose to you, what might be some of the relevant keywords to use in your LinkedIn profile, which may help, your resume to get more noticed. To maybe finding the right roles for you, to even getting you to the right to speak to the right counselor who can help you. So it's all kind of a one-stop shop. So that's another similar example. And of course, if you look at something like Excel, and more recently, I think it's a very significant move from the perspective of when you look at Excel and you deal with large data. Many people with very strong analytical skills have taken a pride in knowing that, oh, I know how to analyze this data and I know how to make sense out of that data. So they will quickly go and pivot it and, build a lot of charts and come back with, okay, this is what I'm seeing. And now guess what? We are already in a preview stage for this. You actually have a tab called Insights, which will basically, on a very large data set, it will proactively propose and put some graphs and charts for you to look at, right? So almost your competitive edge goes away if you're a strong analyst in some ways, but then, as we say, we are going to find other things that the same humans will rediscover themselves and they'll do, something more with it. So those are just some examples of how we are trying to build it. And one thing I didn't touch upon is even in your work product. So let's say something like a Dynamics 365, you would have this powerful aspect called graphs, where you can have all the connections across your, whether it's your SharePoint, whether it's your some third party, you know, like a GitHub code that you have, to your customer, to your competitive intelligence, all at one stop. Now switching gears, in terms of enterprises, I think our aspiration has mostly been on how to help you make sense of your data. Right? In most enterprises, they're sitting on tons and tons of data, number one. Number two, the data is very siloed. So it's very hard and it's in different generations. You know, you could have something sitting even today on an Access database versus, you know, something which is in a NoSQL database. It's all over the place. It doesn't talk to each other. You can't figure out how it can talk to each other. So starting from that to how to make sense out of it and get it into a form where now it starts to become comprehensive for you. So that's kind of been, you know, one of our kind of key focus areas, and I'll talk a little bit more about it when I get to the second piece, which is the platform. Our again aspiration is to provide a one-stop shop in terms of the platform where you can kind of wrangle all these issues and be able to map what you really want to do now based on your use cases. And we are not going to kind of spoon feed you, you must use X database or Y database, but it's like, what's the right thing to do? Of course, based on your use case, based on your size, but also based on the cost and what will make sense based on the, you know, the transformation you really want to drive. And then finally, last but not the least, so whether it is a startup or a kind of a sophisticated enterprise, everybody ultimately will need to deliver things to their customer with some level of SLA and with some level of, whether it is, you know, consistency, uptime, you know, all the usual kind of metrics that we have always done business on. So we do want to make sure that it's not a prototype version, but at every point that the platform is an enterprise-grade platform, which will not fail you, let's say after you've deployed and there's no looking back, because that's, I'm sure none of you want to be in that situation at any point. Now, the last point on that is, but having said that, the platform is also very flexible, where you don't have to or you will not need to change your application or especially your endpoints, web applications, if you just had to switch from database X to database Y, for example. Okay? So at this point, let me just roll a video in terms of how we come real for the enterprises.
Retail is a key engine of the Shea Group. We have 30 million customers every day in one of our branded stations somewhere along the world. We are in over 70 markets.
Shell's retail goal for safety is linked to goal zero, making sure that every visit to every site is done in a safe way and our customers and our staff are safe at all times. Our retail sites are exposed to safety risks ranging from vehicle hitting someone, theft, smoking, also things like wrong refueling behaviours.
Being able to detect those in near time and potentially intervene could be very, very beneficial for us. Historically, we haven't been able to analyse our video footage in its entirety. It's very manually labor intensive to try to analyze the hours of CCTV footage that we capture on our retail sites every day. With computer vision, we can take observations in our physical assets and we can straight away derive insight from them. We've developed a collection of machine learning models that operate both at the edge and in the cloud. We can identify events of interest at the edge in near time. We can pass those into the cloud for tight processing, and we can use the cloud to provide near time alerting. The Azure cloud is powering this transformation. We're now able to take a lot of the platform as a service offerings that Azure gives us, things like IoT Hub and Azure Databricks, combine them with open source technology like TensorFlow and Kafka, and bring that together into a solution quickly. What deep learning gives us is the ability to firstly filter that footage and find events that might be interesting for people to review more closely. But it also allows us to use that same information as labeled footage to train our algorithms and continuously improve.
Instead of a snapshot after an event, it would be a 24/7 ongoing, near real-time data feed that will help us conduct our operations far more safely. And that's wonderful.
The insights we're getting from this gives the service champion a third pair of eyes, which we didn't have before.
We're right at the early stages of the pilot. If we can leverage this technology at scale, we can start to change the way that we do business. And that means making things more effective, reducing cost, and also improving safety. And that's great for us. It's a huge opportunity.
Okay, so let's then talk about what's the secret sauce under it, right? So as I talked about the one-stop shop, so let me delve a little bit on each of these pieces. But as you can see, we want to make sure we provide the infrastructure, we provide the services, and we provide a workbench and tools for you to be productive. So talking a little bit at the infrastructure state, starting from the sheer power, the computing power, which I don't need to go into detail, whether it's CPU-driven, GPU-driven, the works, we have it, and I showed you the Azure kind of layer of the land. Right? If you get to the database options, so right from Cosmos DB, which is basically a NoSQL database, allows you near zero latency. You can kind of auto scale it across geographies, completely seamless for you. Your application does not need to know or be aware of what's going on under the hood. Has APIs which get exposed to a MongoDB or a Cassandra, so you have all the flexibility of what you have. In fact, last week I was at a customer's where they have their entire application and architecture on Java. They've never looked at Microsoft in the past, but it's so easy for them to fit in Cosmos DB in their new architecture because they want to scale as an e-commerce platform globally. Right? When you come to Data Lake, another example, just as the name suggests, if you want to hold really large data sets of diverse types in optimized SKUs, probably use them for training your models, I mean, this is one way to go. If you have something more structured, you have the SQL data warehouse and so on. So there is a whole kind of suite of data options which are kind of separated out from the compute power that you can use. When you come to the compute side, so the one I would probably highlight, or maybe a couple, so for one is the data science virtual machines. So literally, if you had to start doing any kind of a data and AI experiment from scratch, even to get your machines and your hardware in order, you could take weeks to just get going. Okay? With the DSVM kind of environment, you already have kind of pre-packaged image virtual machines ready. It's already existing both on Linux and Windows, depending on what your choice is. So you could literally get them up in a matter of minutes, which is a huge time gain. And then the second part is that it's very optimized in terms of when you're running, you want to scale. And then when something is not running, you want to stop it overnight or whatever. So the cost is going to be very elastic based on how you're using it. So it just gives that kind of power to even like an end developer based on what he or she was trying to do. Similarly, a little bit on the edge, I think you saw it in the video, I spoke about it a little bit earlier as well, that in terms of edge, if you have the ability to do smart analytics and generate insights at your endpoint, then you could do a lot of things, and maybe just one example is around safety, right? So if there were manufacturing plants and there was a spill, and this is again something we are prototyping for a customer as we speak, that they are trying to detect water spill actually in the plant as an accident risk. Now to detect water, right? So in terms of depending on what your floor surface is and how you're going to detect that. Second, maybe relatively more straightforward one is where there is a part of the plant where humans should not be seen after, let's say, 6 p.m. in the evening, and you just detect a human movement in the plant and get an immediate alert, right? So those kind of computing, you want to have the power on the edge and to be able to get immediate insights. Talking a little bit on the services, so they're mostly, three categories. If you really wanted to go quickly, so there is the centerpiece, which is the cognitive services. So whether it is, prepackaged APIs on listening, on seeing, so computer vision, there is a whole stack there, which comes very close to our senses, as I spoke earlier about. It's been trained on millions and millions of data, so if you just wanted to integrate it on your mobile, some particular application, for example, you could just do it. You don't need to, change or customize or do anything more. But if your needs are a little more sophisticated and you want to train it in a custom way, you maybe want it to understand your products really well, or you want to understand your products and your competitors' products a little well, you could go into a custom version where you're training your model to understand and hence respond. And then finally, bots. I think bots have been the buzzword for the last few months, if not more. And so what we're providing essentially is a framework. It's a completely open and flexible framework where you have the power of making your bot as smart as you want. So whether it is on, you want to create a single bot which can run across very different channels and endpoints, or you want it to have a multilingual support, or you want it to understand natural language, you know, the semantics of the conversation and so on, I think that's again something that you can just keep building and making it more and more sophisticated. And again, a lot of banks, as an example, are going through this journey as we speak. Right? And then finally, last but not the least, you do need tools for productivity, right? How do I get started? How do I create my simple Hello World program to doing my first training model in the AI world, right? So we do have, again, tools, different form of tools. So whether you come from a software engineering background, or you come from a data science background, or you come as a business user, there is, you know, there are options for everyone. And then, as I made my point earlier, if you really wanted to get into deep learning or otherwise, there is a whole lot of open source, you know, tools, whether it's TensorFlow, CAF, or, you know, even Onyx, which is kind of a hybrid that we recently released, that you can go to. So there's a whole, I mean, it might almost overwhelm, and which is where we are there to kind of help you in choosing your, you know, the least resistant path with each of this that we have to offer. Finally, switching gears. So having talked about the platform, I do want to come back and spend some time on, you know, what is some of the underlying principles that as Microsoft we totally believe extremely strong in. We heard some part of it around data privacy earlier in Mr. Sahni's presentation as well. That data privacy, trust, I mean, those are things that are completely an underlying foundation for us. Internally, I can tell you, like, there are programs running which would talk about trust, the fact that Microsoft runs on trust and what it means, whether I'm a software engineer or I'm a, you know, I'm a design person or I'm a salesperson working for this organization. And it does remind me in terms, and actually if you see, the quote is very similar to what we have seen in Spider-Man, I'm sure you've all seen, which is, with great power comes great responsibility. And I think that's something that's not about us at all. It's actually about all of us in this room as we get into our AI journey. Because that's almost going to be a make or break of, you know, what and where we are heading with respect to AI. So definitely trust is the underlying theme, number one. And the second part, which is that as we get into this journey, how can we be, you know, more empathetic, more ethical, and, you know, we can really make good use of it. Every time, I mean, I think it's heartening to hear, you know, what it can actually unlock in healthcare, what it can unlock in agriculture. But each of this comes with, you know, that aspect of, as we move in our journey, and I'll use, you know, one of our internal guidelines, which all of you also may find useful, which is pause, think, ask, right? So when you're in doubt, when you're doing something which does not feel right, like, those are really good guiding principles as you take your journey with, you know, your own work, or you're outsourcing it, or you're working for a customer, right? So that's kind of where I would leave this thought. And then finally, maybe touch upon, yeah, what could go wrong, right? I think everybody says also, is it all hunky-dory with AI? Like, you know, everybody talks about, you know, all the cool stuff it can do. But what are some of the things we should just be conscious about and aware about and hence responsible about, right? So I'm not going to go into each of these, but maybe just call out a few and which I've seen personally as we have gone through the journey with the customer. So definitely bias is one that stood out for me. So whether it was even starting from like Donald Trump's elections to more recently, we tried to do some prototype in India where it was given that the model did not understand women who covered their heads. Have you heard of, in the US context, I think we heard about people in burqa, right? So there is a whole aspect of biased data. And you know, and the same thing in, if you talk in terms of robo, for example, I mean, there's been this thing of, if you don't train the robo well, and if you don't show the robo as much of a holistic data, then you might actually be creating racist bots, right? It could be racist if you have more men in your team than women, you know, even that could look different. So this is a non-trivial problem, but I think we just have to be very, very responsible and conscious about what is our baseline training there. And then be open that as we actually engage into real projects, make sure that we are enhancing it and training it better and training it more, you know, evenly. Because ultimately, the output and the result or the insight based on which maybe some executive is going to make a very important decision is going to be driven by that. Right? It is going to be what is our input will determine how good is the output. Right? The other one I might touch upon is maybe singularity. Does everyone here know what singularity? I guess you do. One of the recent articles, this was just like a few days back that I was reading in one of the newspapers, which talked about you know, how the most fearful part on singularity is when AI is being used in defense, right? And the fear is about how you might get into a weaponry which ultimately overtakes humans, and what could that do to us, right? So that's kind of, you know, the part that we should be aware of, but not maybe be overwhelmed with. And so the way I would wrap up is, again, to kind of come back to that same theme of, we actually have a huge responsibility in how AI is being used and how we can unlock its power. And I don't want to say, you know, kind of end on a pessimistic note, but I absolutely think that it's ultimately a power in the hands of humans, right? And so just whether it was starting from, you know, the steam or the discovery of electricity or the internet revolution or this AI that where we are right now, ultimately we are going to define what this technology can do for us and how we can put it to good use. So on that note, I actually want to roll a video which completely, you know, gets humans again at the center of how we are going to unlock what's possible with AI.
Behind every great achievement, every triumph of human progress, you'll find people driven to move the world forward. People finding inspiration where it's least expected. People who lead with their imagination. But in an increasingly complex world, we face new challenges. And sometimes it feels like we've reached our limits. Now, with the help of intelligent technology, we can achieve more. We can access information that empowers us in new ways. We can see things that we didn't see before. And we can stay on top of what matters most. When we have the right tools and AI extends our capabilities, we can tap into even greater potential. Whether it's a life-changing innovation, being the hero for the day, making a difference in someone's future, or breaking down barriers to bring people closer together. Intelligent technology helps you to see more, do more, and be more. And when your ingenuity is amplified, you are unstoppable.
So that's how I would sum it. It's AI is to amplify human ingenuity. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much.